I'm up at Cockington again, and this morning I'm going to go through the basic procedures to make a simple flat band. It's a very simple procedure, but there's some fundamental techniques that I really want to illustrate, and we're going to do it old school. So this is sterling silver. It's 1.2 millimeters thick. As you can see, it's not particularly flat, and it's wider than I need. So we're going to start with this as the starting material, just to flatten it so it's reasonably flat. Notice I'm using the mallet in very specific point, not just flailing away. Now it rocks a little bit, so we turn it over and in the center. And just check there. I think that's... Now I need a straight edge on here. Now, one way would be to draw a line, cut that off. Unfortunately, that would just mean that's waste, which we could remelt, but I don't want to faff about. So I'm going to file this as a curve, use my dividers to mark off the strip I want, cut that off, then I can relatively easily straighten out that strip. Whereas trying to straighten out a big piece would be problematic. Right, so you may be wondering why I'm bothering to file a curve, I need to straighten it later, when this side looks relatively straight. In fact, if we did draw a straight line along here and we could file it, there'd be quite a lot of waste here and here, but that's not really the point. What I'm trying to demonstrate is that as a goldsmith or a silversmith, a smith, you need to learn to control your material, to take it from the raw state. Now, this is a strip of metal that was cast as a cast ingot, forged out and then rolled. So as you saw, it was a bit wavy. So we put it on the flat iron and I flattened it. So I immediately imposed the first level of order on the plate, on the strip. It's now flat. Now I want to take this piece of metal and I want to efficiently use what I've got. So I'm going to file a curve along here, nice even curve, use my dividers set to 6.5 millimeters. I want a 6 mil band when I'm done. I shall cut along, and then I can put it on the flat iron and hammer on the edges very carefully to straighten that strip. And then with a very little bit of filing, I can now dress the other side. And the whole point with this is that at every stage, you're imposing order on the piece. I'm going from the rough ingot, cast, rolled out, and so forth. And through all these stages, at every stage, you're imposing order. Had we measured it while it was still not flat, it wouldn't have been a true measurement. So every step, you're building towards accuracy. Right, so I'm using a standard flat jeweler's 6-inch hand file. It's a coarse one, and I'm just catching the highlights, or the high spots rather. It's up against the bench peg here, nice and secure. My fingers underneath so it can't wobble. And in this instance, I am just looking for a nice, gentle curve. I'm not worried when it's straight or anything other than just a nice, smooth finish. And that will do. Right, having used the coarse file, it's left a bit of a burr. And before I move on, I want to take that off. So I'm using the round of a half round file. A very fine cut, and I'm literally just kissing the edge to take that burr away. Can't feel it. Flip it over, do the same here. You may be wondering why. Well, one is I've got very sensitive hands and I don't like to be scratched. But more importantly, it means that when I measure off, the burr is not going to get in the way. So my dividers are set at 6.5 mil. And now I can run along here. And that's my strip that I need to cut out. Thank you. Right, so here we have the strip. You can see the little curve. I'm going to use a mallet just to straighten it up here. And you can see how easily it now straightened out. So there we have it. We have a straight strip. Easy peasy. And very minimal waste. This job is to get this edge dead straight. One thing to note is that flat files, while they're flat, also do have a slight curve across here. So don't rely on this to be your guide. You need to use a straight edge or a ruler to check that it's straight. So I'm going to just start off by getting the surface cleaned up, and then we'll measure, we'll judge it or check it against the ruler. I'm going from the center out to the edge, and I'll turn it round. Yeah, up to the edge. Now, okay, I'm going to use the ruler to check it. There's a little bit of a curve in the middle. I could have tapped it a bit more on the bench, on the block, I suppose. And we'll get rid of that. Right, I want to get one end square, so I've got it in a little set square, and I'm going to mark the end here. And I can cut that off and file it true. Oh. And using a fine cut file, I'll trim the end. And double check it. Okay. Right, now I need to calculate the length of the strip I need. This ring needs to be a size O. So measuring the internal diameter, I get 17.6. That's 17.6 millimeter. To that, I need to add the thickness of the metal, which in this case is 1.2. And then you multiply by pi. Those of you who are mathematically challenged, that's 3.14. So in this case, it gives us a measurement of 59 millimeters. Cut the strip to 59 millimeters long. Actually, I've cut it ever so slightly smaller than 59, maybe half a mil less. I'll explain why in a moment. This is the filed edge. This edge is not filed, but this is pretty much 6.5 mil wide all along. The edges are 90 degrees here, so they're nice and true. Now, before I go further, if you've melted the metal yourself and you've rolled it out, forged out, whatever, that is say you've processed the material yourself, you may want to examine the metal surface really carefully. Sometimes you may have tiny inclusions, little bubbles, minute cracks. If there is anything like that on either of the sides, that side you can turn to the inside. The reason for that is that by rolling any minute fissures or bubbles to the inside, you're going to contract them by closing them up. Also, you're going to emery the inside, and it's possibly, well, it is, it's less critical than the outside face, which really needs to be perfect, right? So if you have a choice, if there is an issue, have a look at the metal and make sure that any less than perfect metal is on the inside face of the ring. Okay, and now we're going to turn it up. These are just standard half round pliers with some tape on. I'm not in my own studio, so I'm just using what's to hand, because I was a professional, and I can do that. What I would like to just make a point about is that there are, as I understand it, a number of methods that are advanced by various people on the internet, some more vociferous than others. Frankly, it's all kind of irrelevant as far as I'm concerned. If you use your tools carefully and you don't mar the metal, whatever method works for you and whatever you've got to hand. This is, of course, the cheapest and easiest approach, and that's what I'm going to be using. I must have made 1,000 rings as an apprentice goldsmith, and this is what I used. The only time I didn't use these were when we were making very heavy rings, where the metal was, say, over 2 millimeters, and then we would use a ring bender. Alternatively, I have a very large engineer's vise with smooth jaws, and I will use a perhaps a bar of steel or a drill bit shank, and I will hammer directly with a leather mallet to form. We'll do a tutorial on that at some other point. But for now, we're just going to use the old faithfuls. I'm going to start at the end and give it a bit of a turn, just very gently. I'm going for, and then I can come back the other side to correct that. And that's adequate for my needs. I can go to the other side. Around. All I'm really concerned about at this point is these two faces meeting neatly. Not perfect, but these two faces need to be nice and parallel. Now I can just gently turn up the rest. It's not a massive job. Try to keep them even. The perils of performing in front of a camera, you can't really see what you're doing. No, I'm going to push the one past the other, underneath, there we go. And now I'm going to go to a ring mandrel. Pop it on, bring it back until it pops apart. There we have it. I'm going to use a mallet now, just to give it a bit of a roundness. Not really necessary. I don't want to bring the faces around neatly. Right, so I've just taken this off the mandrel, and as you can see, it's not perfectly round, and that's not important at this point. But what is important is that these two ends are approaching each other. They're butting up quite nicely. There's no real distortion in the ends, which is important. If there was distortion, we'd have to file it true, and then we'd lose thickness. We can't afford to do that. Now, if I just simply press this together, you can see that the joint is pretty good. So all I have to do now, very carefully, bending down here, bring these two faces in, pass, and then that side again. Tricky, trying to do it for the camera, but let's see if I can do that so you can see what I'm doing. You can see and I can't, there we go. So that's pretty good. It's really important to feel the inside. I don't want to feel a step. If there's a step there, it means I'm going to have to file that level. And as I said before, you're going to lose metal. So it's really critical that that is flat. Now, as you saw when I pulled the one under and then clipped the under, this is under tension now. But this isn't a perfect joint. It looks pretty good. We could probably get away with soldering it. But I want to illustrate a point. In fact, yes, if this wasn't a film for you, I wouldn't do anything now, I'd simply solder it, because it's that good. But I'm going to saw through it with a saw blade, so that we then get a really true mating of those two faces. It's also why earlier, and I said I cut the length half a mil short of the required 59, and now I'm going to take away another sliver of metal. So the ring will be undersized, but that's important because I need to tap it up with a steel hammer. And I know some of you probably cringe at this moment because it seems to be commonplace to use a leather mallet. I'll explain why I don't think that's the optimal way to make a ring when I get to that point. So I'm now going to slice through this joint. There we have it. Right, so I've cut through. The joint is now pretty tidy. I've checked again that it's nice and smooth on the inside. I don't want any irregularities. Now, I'll move on to soldering in a moment, but before we do that, there's one thing I want to do, and that is to run a needle file just on the inside here, because we sawed through, and there's a little burr there. Now, burrs can stop solder from flowing neatly, and I really want this to flow nice and true, and so I tend to just very lightly, run the needle file over the back. It also helps clean the metal. And it's just the lightest of touches. I'm literally just cleaning away any burr and tidying up that metal. So that's that ready to go.
I'm set up now to solder the ring. I'm using borax cone. I've used this my entire career. See no reason to change. They're cheap. I enjoy grinding borax. The ring is held in locking tweezers for the moment, just so I can apply the borax. This is silver hard solder. It's been cut in little strips at the end, and then using shears, you can cut across to produce little squares, which are called pallions. Now, I rarely, if ever, apply a pallion directly to a ring, and I'm not a great fan of stick solder application. So what I do is this. It's quite important that you don't use too much solder. Solder isn't a gap-filling material. It's to bond the two surfaces. And done properly, the solder will penetrate into the silver on either side and create a new alloy, in effect, between the two pieces. So you just need a very small amount of solder. So I'm going to nip a bit off here. You place your finger under the solder and cut into your finger, and it's on your fingertip. Pop it onto the charcoal there. So I'm going to put some borax on the solder, and we're going to bead it up prior to putting it in position on the ring. There, it's covered in borax. Seems more trouble than it ought to have been. Right, now I'm going to apply the flux to the join on the ring. Flux is in place. Now I'm going to put the ring flat, like that. Now, if you remember, that upper edge was left as it was sawn off. Now I'm going to put the solder on that edge. Not there. Now, the reason I do that is when the solder flows, there will inevitably be a little bit of spread on either side. But because this area has not been filed yet, that's where the, most of the filing will be performed to dress the ring and to get it to dimension correctly. So any excess solder will be removed there. And I don't want any solder on either of the two board faces. So I'm going to heat the ring in the back and try and bring both sides to the same temperature so the solder will run down the center. To keep an eye on that, I want to be able to see the joint, and you can see the back side of it. And typically, I didn't use a soldering pick because it wasn't hand, so I was lazy. And predictably, the solder didn't go perfectly on both sides. So although the solder join is okay, I'm going to add a tiny snippet more. So I've made another little bead here, and I'm going to apply it, and this time I shall use the soldering pick. So don't do what I did. Use a soldering pick from the beginning. You can make sure the solder does go where you want it. I made the mistake on purpose so I could help you find a way to solve the problem.
The solder joint is now adequate. I won't say perfect, but yes, it probably is okay. It's really important not to quench solder joints, in my opinion. If you do quench it, you may end up with, because this is a slightly different alloy in the join, you may embrittle that solder joint. So it's wise just to let it cool. And if you do, if you are in a hurry, you can always put the locking tweezers on the joint and dip it in water so the bottom half of the shank cools down. And then at that point, of course, it's probably fine to put it in pickle. What you're trying to avoid is thermal shock on the solder joint. Just as a general rule, it's probably not wise to subject the solder joints to that kind of trauma. Anyway, so it's now cool enough to put in the pickle. Is it cool enough to touch? Oh, it's probably cool enough to touch. Probably not for humans, just for goldsmiths. Yes, pickle it and clean it, and then we'll get back to finishing it up. So here it's been in the pickle, it's nice and clean now. And as you can see on the inside, the solder join is nice and tidy. Solder hasn't flooded onto the sides. And that's, of course, where the solder was placed. And of course, as you can see, that's the sawed edge, so we can file it off. Unfortunately, as you saw, I did have an issue because I didn't use a soldering pick at the beginning because I was lazy and couldn't be asked to go and fetch it. So solder did, in fact, flood onto the outside surface. It's really important that I file that away before we hammer the ring up, because otherwise the solder will be forced into the surface. And in time, as the ring tarnishes, that will show up as a horrible blemish. So we need to remove that. Before we proceed. Right. So I'm using the half round, very fine file. I'm using a half round because I don't actually want a flat on here at this point. Having bent the ring up, this plane is slightly dished all the way around. And I just want to get rid of the solder here. So this is remedial work. Just very gently picking it up, coming off my thumb. And I can actually feel the solder is harder than the silver itself. So I can tell when the solder's actually gone. And while I'm about it, I might as well tidy up the entire joint. Very, very delicately, just taking off the bare minimum. I have allowed for a sliver of material which you filed off afterwards. And I really don't want to take off any more than I absolutely have to here. Okay, that's good enough. One other thing to say, it really is important to pickle things before you file them, because the residue from the flux is a bit like glass, really, and it will blunt your files very quickly. So always good to make sure that your metal is nice and clean in the pickle before you start to file it. Okay. Before going on to the triblet to hammer it up, I need to also make sure that there's no solder and on the inside join, and that it's a nice true face. So I'm just very lightly going to cross that. And because it's nicely lined up, you can see that there's very little to do. It's really important to do this, because if you leave any solder there, the solder being harder than the silver, it'll get pounded into the surface. And that really isn't very professional. And then also, if you don't file it out, because the solder's harder, and you do tap up the ring, you will end up with a little seam that you can see no matter what you do. So it's best to file it out now, and then when we go on to the polished ring mandrel triblet, all this will smooth out very nicely. Right, leather mallet, I'm just going to tap the ring up to true round. And I'll avoid the solder joint for now. I'm pulling the ring down as I'm tapping. And back. And tap it off, turn it around the other way. And every now and again, you need to look down the length of the mandrel so you can see whether the ring is truly round. Notice I avoided the solder area, so these two little shoulders aren't quite touching, and that's fine, we'll get to that later. That's reasonably round. Because I'm using a leather mallet, though, the faces are still slightly convex. A leather mallet isn't hard enough and direct enough to get this plane flat. Okay, so we're going to take it loose and check. Right, having filed the inside of the ring very lightly to remove any excess solder and the outside, I've tapped it with the leather mallet on the mandrel, so it's reasonably round. And checking the size, it needs to be an O, so it's just over O. To correctly size a ring like this, it's 6mm wide. That O mark there needs to be in the center of the ring. So I estimate the ring needs to come up to that black line there. So I've got a couple of mil to move it up. Similarly, the other side. And the reason I want to use a steel hammer now is you can see there's a slight curve on those faces. Now if I file that flat, I'm simply making the edges look thinner. And I don't want the edges to look thinner because it makes the ring look flimsy and cheap. So I'm going to hammer it up. Also, hammering means that the ring is truly round, and it the metal is nicely compacted, and perhaps a little bit harder. So that's what we're doing next. So I'm using a relatively flat polished hammer, and the trick is to hammer directly onto the metal. So avoid the temptation to tap the edges, because you will end up hammering your ring mandrel, and if I ever see a ring mandrel full of marks, I'll sneer at you. So you want to keep it flat, because if you do hit the edges, you're going to thin the edges, and of course that's not the objective. We want to get these planes flat. So the trick is to work very evenly and lightly. So starting, and I'm avoiding the solder joint initially. Tap it off and do the other side. And checking the round. Check the size again, and I think that's pretty close to perfect. I'm going to give it the lightest of taps one more time. That'll do. We'll check that the sides are parallel and the ring is square. You don't want a wonky size. So I think we're okay there. And just double check the sizing again. Yep, that's perfect.
So if you remember from the outset, this is the edge that was filed. So I'm going to take this face as our datum point, and I'm going to file it truly flat. But just to show where we're at right now, putting it up on the square, you can see that the what was slightly cupped face is now pretty much flat. And as I rotate the ring on that flat initial filed surface, you can see that the face of the ring is relatively flat and even all the way around. This all seems perhaps a little mechanical, but this particular ring will have a laser design cut onto the surface, so it really does need to be very accurate. And of course, in a broader context of developing skill and training yourself, this attention to detail and this care and precision transfers to everything else you do. And this is, in my opinion, the fundamental basis of craft and skill development.
Right, so this is the filed size, filed side, coarse file, and I'm just going to flatten this. Couple of strokes, turn it. The reason I'm turning it is to even the filing out, so we're not just putting pressure on one side, because as you file you inevitably put more pressure on one side or the other. So we keep turning it, don't concentrate on any particular blemish, just keep going around. And that should be that. And now I'll go to a fine cut. There's a couple of bits of silver stuck in the file. These need to be cleaned. So it's creating little scratches, but nothing too bad that the emery won't get rid of it. So that's one side. Right, so that side's nice and flat. I have to measure the ring now. So vernier gauges are really nice. I don't like these digital ones for a number of reasons, which I'll rant about in another video. So we've got 6.4, we've got 6.42, got 6.41. What I like about the vernier gauges, digital or analog, is that the jaws are parallel and I can feel it's fractionally thicker there. Not that that 0.02 matters, but at least I know where it is. So we've got 0.4 of a mil to take down. So if you'll leave the good side alone and concentrate on the other side. And working evenly, yes, I know that the ring is reasonably parallel sided now. Test it. All right, it's 6.34, so we've come down a tenth of a mil, a little bit more. Okay. All right, so I've been filing down the wayward side and periodically measuring it, making sure that I'm bringing the edge in evenly, and now we're just approaching 6.1, so we'll check now. And now I'm not doing the whole thing. Well, I can do there. It's 6.09, 6.1, 6.13. Oh, it's a little thick bit there. So we'll just touch it here, just a little snippet. Now I'm going to take it. And that's close to 6.1. I'm going to just gently go around before I go to a fine file. That's 6.06. 6.12. What's that all about? A bit of thickness there. So I'm going to use a finer file now. Could quite possibly be those dodgy. Okay. Alright, so now I'm getting the final finish. I'm using the fine file now, blending everything in. Zero that. Oh, that doesn't help. Nope, that's a new zero now. 6.02. Thank you. 6.01. I can live with a 1/100th of a millimeter deviation. I'm not too ashamed of that. Right, so the last thing to do, I know that it's fairly commonplace just to simply go with emery now over this. You could do that, I suppose, but I want to make sure the surface is perfectly flat, and having hammered it, that all of these little marks and any blemishes are properly removed. So I'm using a fine cut file, and it's just a very light touch. There we are. You see, I've established a flat from side to side. Now I just move on the same, and I'm just maintaining exactly that. And I'm watching the marks as they move across evenly, nice straight line. If it deviates, this line deviates, that little dip there is fine because there's still probably a little bit of a shallow there. If this line starts to deviate, I know that I'm dipping too much on either side. So I really have to keep my eye on those marks. If the marks your tool make aren't the marks you want to see or need to see, you need to change what you're doing. Seems fairly straightforward, but in fact that's all developing skill is about. You have to pay attention. And you only have to do this once if you do it right. And the trick is not to move forward until you've covered the entire surface.
Show me the difference between the first, the beginning, and the end.
So here we have.
Tilt it a bit.
Okay. So I've started here, got a nice flat, and then just worked forward off that. I put the file on there, you can see that's dead flat across the surface. I'm not rolling the edges. So these corners are nice and crisp. Okay, here if I put it, you can see there's a slight dip in the center, ever so slight. But the filing is intended to remove that. Okay. And keeping the piece steady on the bench peg, moving very methodically across the piece, and say keeping an eye on those marks. It's like a little wave gently moving across the surface. And you don't move forward until you've properly covered each little millimeter as you inch back. You don't inch forward, you millimeter forward. It's just a matter of practice, but it's only by being very attentive to what you're doing do these kind of actions become part of your body memory and thereby your body skill in your craft. And I'm doing this relatively slowly, to be honest, not saying that to show off, but just to make the point that you really do need to work at a pace at which you can see. So no point filing faster if you can't really keep an eye on things. This is the solder joint area. It sounds a little different, perhaps a little harder. You can hear that slightly different tone. That's in fact the solder on the outside. Right. So this was a skill that I developed as an apprentice. My first year as an apprentice, I made primarily wedding rings, flat rings like this, half round bands as well. I'll do a separate film on making half round bands. And I would do anywhere from 6 to 8 a day. And some weeks it was just so monotonous. But I always reminded myself that one day my dream was to make Japanese sword fittings, and my filing needed to be really, really precise. And of course, now I do make Japanese sword fittings. Right, so now we're going to emery. This is a buff stick. This is the, I don't know, what is this, 600 grit maybe? It's a bit worn. This will be adequate. So again, just as with filing, do a little bit, trying to apply even pressure front and back, and just move it around. It shouldn't take much because the filing, and that's it, really. And do the other side. One, two, three, and four for good luck. That's the sides done. And now, I guess there would be a natural tendency to want to do this. And I would avoid that myself because the buff stick will roll side to side and you'll end up with mushed edges. So instead we're going to do exactly what we did before, but we're going to angle the emery paper ever so slightly so we can perhaps see, although frankly the emery's so fine. Okay, I'll try it here and you can see better. There you go. I can now see the file marks disappear. Awkward like this, but this is where you can at least see what I'm doing. So now I'm going to emery the inside because I filed the join before we started and my ring mandrel hasn't been mangled by students or other miscreants. It's still relatively smooth after all these years. So the inside is nice and smooth and compounded. So I'm going to use the emery on a little rotary rod in the pendant drill. And very carefully, I'm just going around, not trying to do anything other than keep it flat. gonna, there's a few little marks. Okay, so I'm doing it a bit, it's a bit awkward. I'm going to keep out of the way so you can see. There's a few little marks in there. And this is set up for a left-handed person. I'm not a left-handed person. There's a few marks in there that I want to work on. And for the purposes of this demonstration, I think that will suffice. So the last thing to do before polishing is to cut the inside edge. You may have seen a previous film where I demonstrated the use of a scraper. A jeweler's scraper is that little triangular piece of metal. It's about that long. You've probably seen it. It looks like a little spear point, and you've possibly wondered what on earth it was for. Well, it's for this sharp edge. You can lose it with emery paper. I don't like that way because it just blurs the edges. I like a nice precise cutting the arras, as the technique would be called in woodworking or stonemasonry. So this is a Japanese scraper, so we'll pretend this is a jeweler's scraper. And you just go along and cut that corner. I'm resting the whole tool flat on the inside. You can see the little slivers coming off. You can make it quite smooth. And the other side. This was one of the most satisfying parts, certainly when you finish the ring and it's all come out just as you wanted. Now there you have it. So there we have it. That's essentially the completed ring. You remember how we started out with a sheet that wasn't very flat. And at every stage we've imposed more order. We now have a ring that is a nice consistent thickness. And one of the points that I would like to make is that the solder joint shouldn't be immediately evident. There's a little thin bit where the solder joint is. That, for me, is a mark of poor craftsmanship. The sides are perfectly parallel. The ring is within a tenth of a millimeter of 6 mil, which was the required width. Size is exactly right. So as far as I'm concerned, that's a job well done. Right, so this is a little addendum after the fact, which all addendum are, really, aren't they? Anyway, it just occurred to me another reason for filing the outside as opposed to just emery papering is that this is a sterling silver ring. So inevitably, you're going to get fire scale all around the outside. That's that dark, cloudy oxide within the metal, which is an inevitable consequence of soldering sterling silver, unless you coat it in borax all over, which can be a bit mucky. So because we've actually filed the outer surface, we've eliminated any fire scale. Whereas had I only emeried it, it's very likely that there would have been traces of fire scale. But by filing, we eliminate yet another problem.